both in person and through Facebook. Got a couple announcements this morning. First, I'm going to ask a question. Are we going to have communion next Sunday? Because that's when it's scheduled. All right, so we're going to try to do communion next Sunday. On Friday, October 2nd, we will be having the gathering here. And then another announcement is that Family Hope Center is having their banquet, their annual banquet, on Friday, October 16th. But because of social distancing restrictions, the Club 86 is only at 25% capacity. So they have asked folks to hold their own watch parties, and we are going to have a watch party here. And so that's going to be taking place again at 6:30 on Friday, October 16th. There are invitations that are available. We do have a limit here of 20 people. So the first 20 people to come and pay will be the folks that get to attend. Masks are required when not eating. If you'd like some invitations or some details, please see either Donna Reinvolt, Barb Kraus, Ruth Fryer, or Julie Bates. Okay, and then lastly, I do have some encouraging news from Pakistan about Shamela. The test came back, and she has an infection in her pancreas, which is better than what we thought that she was having. And so she's being still treated at the hospital, and her condition is slowly improving. So continue to keep her up in prayer. And I invite you now to please join us for praise and worship this morning.
Come, send your rule and reign.
Yeah.
You can spend your life chasing what's missing, but that empty inside just ain't gonna listen. With nothing can satisfy, the world leaves you high and dry. Just come to the well, and all who thirst in my arms a while, feel the change, my child, when you come to the well. And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will try, and it can never leave it all behind and come to the well. The world may try, but it can never fail. Leave it all behind. And now that you're full of love beyond measure, your joy's gonna flow stream in the desert. Soon all the world will see the living water is found in me, 'cause you come to the well.
Hallelujah.
And all who thirst will thirst no more, and all who search will find what their souls long for. The world will
God, love it. Absolutely love it. I'm going to be talking about that today. You can turn your Bibles to, first of all, to Matthew chapter 22. And while you're turning there, I want to make a couple announcements. One, sadly, we lost the Catholic Church in the building this week. They finally had to close their doors. We lost the smallest Spanish-speaking church about a month ago. And so the chapel's open for the next move of God and to see what God's going to do with that. We've learned a lot by having six different churches in the building, and we're down to three now. And we're much wiser, and we're understanding what God's doing with the building. And as Mark Reese told the elders, the leaders' line, we're together, but not the same. And we need to realize that God has put his body and brings his body in different churches into this building for his glory. Now, I want to read out of Matthew 22, 34 through 40. 34 through 40. But when the Pharisees had heard that he put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, who was a lawyer, asked a question of Jesus, testing him. Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And this is the first and great commandment. Now the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And on these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets. Otherwise, it all works right if you love God with all of your heart, soul, and mind, and you love others as you love yourself. It all works, and it gives us perfection that God has for us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your love is a healing and a wholesome love. We thank you that we can pray for Shamela. We can pray for Tootie and Bobby's sister and other prayer requests that are unspoken here today and that are live. Father, that you would minister your grace to them, you would show your love to them, and that love would heal and restore. Bless each and every person that comes into this building today. It's your house. It's your church. Bless the individual churches, Lord. Let us all lift up Jesus Christ. Let the Spirit of God move among us and be alive and well. And we thank you for that in your holy name. Amen. I want to encourage everybody to continue reading 1 John. And you can either read the book of John also, but 1 John, back by Revelation. Go back to Revelation and turn left a couple books. Read 1 John and you'll see where we are as a church and where you're to be as an individual and a family in the church. And I had a word of knowledge this week that the answer to all of life's questions is, how much do you love God? Now I want to say that again. I want you to think about it. The answer to all of life's questions, every question you have, the answer to that is, how much do you love God? Because God's love has all the answers for our life. If you're in Sunday school this morning and Melissa said that God created all the universe and He created you, His love created you and is with you. So to answer all life's questions is, how much do you love God? And so as you think about that and you're in God's love, then all of a sudden He gives you the answer and the understanding He has for you. See, the love of God heals and delivers. The love of God leads and establishes you. The love of God will heal today those that we prayed for. The love of God will heal you physically. The love of God will heal you emotionally. The love of God will heal relationships. A few weeks ago, I had a touch of God's love, a new touch of God's love. And that's why I'm on the theme of love. Matter of fact, that's why we're going to have in our script, Faith Community, House of Love. Faith Community, House of Love. And we all have the challenge to make that very real to ourselves, to each other, and to everyone that enters this building. And when I had that touch, this new touch of love, something happened to me. Matter of fact, you're thinking, and I've said over and over how I heard years ago, love, 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 that's all I hear in the church. Well, I'm using that, I'm turning a little bit, love, 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 that's all you're going to hear in the church, because that is God. I loved what Melissa did in putting that sign instead of just talking about love, it's God, because that's what God is. God is love. And so this touch of love that I had a few months ago instantly released me from emotional baggage that I've carried for years. It instantly cleansed me. It was like standing in a shower and it just all washing away and down the drain. And I stood there with this sense of God's love and free from myself. And it was like, whoa. It was like I didn't know what to do. It was like, and that's when the word came to me, nothing sticks to love. If you're in God's love, nothing of the past sticks with you. Nothing negative of the present sticks with you. It cannot stick. Did it bother Jesus? Then it shouldn't bother you. When God created you, He created you and me to have His love and the fulfillment of God's love. See, when we're in God's love, we have life and life abundantly. And when we are not in that love, we have turmoil. So you can ask yourself, happy? You're in love. Frustrated? Lack of love. See, there's no shortness of God's love. There's no lack in God's love. And so when we're in a situation in just daily living and we're wondering, what to do, we're wondering about a situation, why did this or that happen or what was said, and so when we're evaluating daily, we need to stop and realize that God is with us, He loves us, He's full of love, and now in that love, we can make a decision. In that love, we can respond the way God wants us to respond. There's no shortness in God's love. There's no death, there's no dying, there's no destruction in God's love. Well, you say, well, what happens when there is death, dying, and destruction? Well, that's because we're in the world. But when death, dying, and destruction comes into our life, because we're in the world but not of it, then we need to realize, God, we're in the world and not of it, but here's a taste of death, dying, or destruction. I really, really need Your love. I'm overwhelmed with this issue in my life. I really, really need Your love. And so God then gives us sensation, gives us this evidence of His love in us. See, God's love has all the components for living a victorious life. All the answers, all the understanding, all the living with God truths. A word of knowledge, Melissa, I get to ring the bell as well. This morning while Kevin and I were praying, love is a treasure box of truths. Love is a treasure box of truths. Love is. Everything else is the results of love or lack of. So love is, here's your treasure box of all the truths you need in life. Here's all the answers that you need in life. So how much do you love God? How much are you willing to listen to God before you have that response? Before you take that decision, before you make that decision or take that, how much do you love God? What is God's answer for you? And so when we look at how much do you love God in your everyday life, how about your lifestyle? What are your expectations in life? And where are they from in loving God? Are they in sync with God's love and your love for Him? Can you say, this is how God wants me to live? I've made this decision because God has brought that into my life, because I sense the presence of God. It lines up with the Word of God. And people, it will not be contradictory to the Word of God. And so when you sense that you need to think about something, make a decision, or respond, you need to know, thus saith the Lord God, in Scripture and in my spirit, and they flow together. Or how about the love of God in obedience? See, what are your decisions based on? How is God going to reward you? How much do you love God in that decision? Or faithfulness? Faithfulness is your proof of loving God. Or how about in your daily blessings? How much can God bless you? As He can trust you, so as He can bless you. I thought Melissa got a hold of my notes ahead of time, but I know she didn't because I didn't have them out there. But this is her Sunday school, and it's like, you think God might be saying something to us? See, trust is a base. Trust is out of that treasure box of love. We can trust each other with God's love. Can He trust you? I read this past week that 79% of NFL football players, the millionaires and on, are broke in 2 years after they stop playing. 150 million, one person. 50 million, one person. One quarterback just got 15 million for 1 year. But 79% of them are broke and declare bankrupt in 2 years after playing. Why? Because they can't be trusted with finances. They blow them. And God is not a God that's going to waste His blessings. And so can God bless you? Can God trust you to bless you? And when you look at the loves of God, how about trials in your life? Can you move from the why to the what? Do you beg during the whys? Do you curse God during the whys? Or do you thank God for the what is He doing in your life? See, how about brokenness? When it all seems lost, or at least it seems lost to you, when you're all alone, do you love God? Do you trust God? Do you say, you know, God, this seems to be a black night of the soul. This seems to be like David said, when my soul's in the pit, I think I'm in the pit now, God. I don't see any light. I don't see, you know, there's darkness all around, but like the song we sang, there's light from above. And so we turn our inner reflection upon God. And there's nothing wrong in begging God. There's nothing wrong in pleading to God. There's nothing wrong. You look at Scripture, you look at Psalms, you look at Job, they were real people. Same with the New Testament. They gave up. Here they walked with Jesus and turned around and gave up. We need to realize that there's times in our lives we're just real people, and so were the people in the Old Testament and the New Testament. They had their ups and they had their downs, but through it all, they found the love of God. The love of God was their stay, and that should be in our lives. Or how about temptations? Of course, the obvious ones that we all fight, that we say, oh, well, yeah, that's me. But how about those secret ones? How about loving God so much that those temptations flee? And this always amuses me When people say, well, yeah, but you don't know my temptation, Jesus does. And guess what? Jesus was tempted in all manner as you and I are. Well, no, not Jesus. No, because you don't know. Jesus knows, and he said he was tempted in all manner like you and me, but he didn't go there. And so in our lives, when we realize, what about temptation? I was talking to my wife this morning driving in. She said, well, what are you thankful for? And we start listing what we're thankful for. And I was telling her about this touch of love, to where all of a sudden baggage fell off. Baggage I've been wrestling with for years just fell off. It was resentment from the past, just fell off. And she said, well, how do you apply that? I said, well, because when I start to go back over and pick up some of that baggage, then I get to be me. And I can now be upset and get angry and remember when, or I can put that dirty thing down and I pick up the love of God and say, God, thank you for delivering me. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for touching me with the love of God, where I let that go. And now it's really my choice to walk in the fullness of God or to walk in the flesh with that emotional conflict. So in our minds and in our lives, we need to realize nothing sticks to the love of God in your life. How about others? Do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. Can you sense God's love? You just stop and say, God, I want to sense, I want to receive your love. And you just start basking in that love, and then you start sending it to people. You start practicing sending that love to people. Do it to people you love. Do it to people you like. Do it to your family. It's easy. Do it to your neighbor. Do it to the person you work with. And play a game and just say, send you love, send you love. Send you love, send you. And you start playing a game with that, and then after a while you realize you really are sending God's love to them. You realize, wait a minute, if I can do that to people that are easy, I can do that to people that aren't so easy. I mean, how many of us have some people we don't like? Don't raise your hands. The other churches have them, but not us. People we don't like. Or how about people, let's be honest, I mean, it's real close to hate. It's real close to hate. Die if you want, not my problem. How about sending love to them? You know, with this concept of this new touch of love, I started looking back at people I've resented that for whatever reasons. And this week, I just sent them love and sent them love. And I said, God, for every person I've ever cursed, for every person I've ever called a name, for every person every person I just sent, for every time I was upset with them, I pray, multiply your love in their life. Let them know how much you love them today, wherever they are. See, Ephesians 3:19 says, and to know the love of Christ which passes understanding. The love of Christ which passes understanding. There's a movie that my wife was watching, and this woman was having conflict with her boyfriend, soon-to-be husband, maybe. And so she's talking to her mother about it, and her mother says, well, do you love him? And her response is, oh, Mom, I love him awful. She says, then marry him. And so this morning the question is, do you love God awful? I mean, are you in love with God? And the love that passes understanding, it's a love that's eternal, not merely temporal or worldly. You realize that you're in love with Almighty God. Somebody called for counseling this past week at 1 o'clock in the morning, and I stagger in, pick up the phone, and a man was having a problem in another state, and he's really, really wrestling with something. He was angry, he was hurt, he was, you know, and so he said, I want to know why. And I said, you don't get a why answer. There's no why. People, none of you know the why answer for issues in your life. You know, but you do know the what. And anyway, we talked about that, and as soon as I said that, it's like a light came on with him, and he started thanking me for answering the phone, for being in the ministry. I said, okay. And just know that God's working with you. God loves you. Now, as I went back to bed, I started thinking about that and praising God that God, just like that, changed grief to thanksgiving. I thought, that's God. That's God's love. That's God's love. And so I was thinking about that. People, you ought to hear my messages that I preach in bed. They're fantastic. I mean, they're fabulous. And I'm going to tell, and so I'm kind of going to sleep, and I'm in this lucid dreaming. I know I'm dreaming, but I'm still, and I'm thinking how good God is and how much I love God. Now this sounds a little juvenile. It's even a little embarrassing, okay? And this dream I had, it was like, you know, and I started thinking about King Kong, who climbed the Empire State Building, and he got up on top, and I'm up on top of, I'm up on the lightning rod, okay? I'm on the Empire State Building because I want to get as close to God as I, you know. And I'm thanking God, and lightning goes, and instead of being afraid, I said, go ahead, God, strike me with your love. See, God doesn't strike us with death. He strikes us with his love. I said, strike me with your love. And then I started thinking, and in my dream, I'm worshiping God. And then I realized I'm on top of the Empire State Building holding on to the, I'm going to get down. And so I skinny down the outside of the building. I go inside, and I run down the stairs to the basement. And then I go down to the sub-basement and the sub-sub-basement. Now, I don't know why I did all that in the dream, but it was there. And so I find this little tiny hidden place in the sub-sub-basement behind, because that was God. And now I want to hide because I realize that was God. And it's like, I just want to hide down here. You know, let the rocks fall on me, as the scripture says. Let me hide. Except for the love of Jesus Christ doesn't make God fearful. In the love of Jesus Christ, you're all right with God. And with the love of Jesus Christ, we find God's love. See, when we think about God, we generally think about what God does, not what God is. We kind of love God, but we seldom love God awful. But we need to practice that. We need to ask God for that. We need to be able to say, God, I love you, and feel good about that. And feel like, you know, God is listening. And it's the need to be with God, the need to be in God, to be in God's love with our whole spirit, soul, and body, and loving others as we love ourselves. Now, in John 15, we're told, there's no greater love than laying down your life for another, just like Jesus Christ laid down his life for you. For you, for me, and for everyone we know. That we would lay down our lives for Jesus Christ. Now, I used to think about, well, that means being a martyr, and I'll go over to some other country, you know, and be... No. Laying down our lives, we do that regularly in our life. We do that at work. How many times at work you have to hold your peace? How many times you're with your neighbor, with the family, you know, you just have to hold your peace. Don't go there. And, you know, the more, and again, it's this love thing. Somebody was talking to me this past week, and they were telling me how to have a flower garden. And I wanted to say, my wife and I had 5 gardens, and we were on Ontario County Garden Tour, and they had men with tucks, and they were giving hot and cold hors d'oeuvres and playing the violin. I wanted to go into all that. I know how to make a garden. But this man was real happy about his garden. And so I listened to him, and I asked him what kind of flowers and what kind of arrangement. And by the way, he doesn't know how to make a garden. I said, well, what's your center, what's your focus? Well, what do you mean you focus? I love the whole, you don't know, you have to have a focus. You know. And I'm thinking of all this, and I thought, just hold your peace. It's not a, he enjoys his garden. Let him tell, I had another woman last week tell me that I need to make sure I water my garden. And I need to water it in the morning or water it in the evening, because otherwise it's not good for it. And I'm thinking, my garden, and I just hold my peace. Now, people, that's dying to self. See, I don't want to best them because they're telling me about their occurrence. And that's die to self and let the other person be built up. Ask them about the garden and ask them about, you know, why, because that's what they're doing in their life. And so many times we lay down our lives because we just don't have to give our opinion. Well, what if you're right and they're wrong? Is God telling you to give your opinion? Or is he telling you to hold your peace because that's not where they are and they need to talk about whatever they're talking about? So often laying down our life means giving up our need to be right or our opinions. My wife and I have this thing between us that we have a saying with family members and others, would you rather be right or would you rather have the relationship? And because if you're going to tell your opinion and be right, it's going to hinder that relationship. Well, yeah, but what if they're, no. Would you rather be right, I told you so, Or would you rather have the relationship? And so in God, and when God's love is in our life, often laying down our right. Matter of fact, let's turn to that scripture. And that scripture is in John 15, in John 15, verses 19 through 14. In John 15, verses 9 through 14. And the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue in my love. If you keep my commandment, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in his love. Okay, now we're living in love. We're living in God. God in us, we in him. These things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might remain in you and that your joy might be full. Are you happy? You got joy? You got God. You know, we need a new sign. You know, that got milk, got God. I've seen a bumper sticker like that. Got God. You happy? You got God. You're not happy? You're missing God. Got happy? You've got love. You're not happy? You're missing love somewhere. There's something that's not connecting with you. Yeah, but I know what I believe. And if you're still miserable and still uncertain, then you're missing the love of God. But no, I've got the peace of God. It says right here that you may, that the joy of the Lord be in you and that your joy might be full. Not just sometime, but you'd live a life of joy because of God's love. And this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. I'll love you according to God. You love me according to God. Our joy will be full. And greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. And so many times it's just a matter of laying down our life, holding our tongue, or yielding, listen, our desires for his desires. What does God have for you? And what do you want to do? And is God in that? Truly, truly in that. So how much do you love God? Remember this, people. Word of knowledge. Word from God. The answer to all questions in life. How much do you love God? And so you can ask yourself that. You know, I got an answer. Lord, I got to make a decision. Am I thinking right? Am I responding right? Am I doing right? Find the love of God, because God's love is a treasure box full of truths for you. So look into the treasure box of love, which is Jesus Christ and the Word of God. Let's stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us, and the proof of that love is you, Lord Jesus, that you went to the cross and took it all on the cross, all the ugly, and you rose again to give us new life. And so, Father, we lay it all at the cross daily. Father, we thank you daily for the love of God in our life. And I just pray a blessing on everyone here and everyone in sound. Lord, bless them with your love. Let us truly, truly, truly sense and receive the love of God. And we thank you for it in Christ's name. Amen. I want to remind everybody.
All of us will reach a crossroads in life, a decision that has to be made. Some can be small and insignificant. Others seem like they could shape the course of our entire lives. How can we know the will of God? How can we correctly choose the path He has set out for us? And what if we make the wrong decision? We spend sleepless nights and days filled with anxiety when we place these burdens upon ourselves. Often we become isolated, feeling completely alone in finding the right answer. Sometimes we're tempted to rush into a decision. Other times we'd rather delay indefinitely. But for those who call Him Father, for those who believe in the power of His name, He provides everything we need to follow His will. He gives us His Word as a compass and inspiration. Those who live according to Scripture will always follow in His footsteps. He blesses us with wise counsel through His church and the leaders He has set in place. He hears our every prayer, granting peace and wisdom to those who ask. His very Spirit dwells in us, a still small voice that guides from within our hearts. And in His perfect timing, He will open doors. He will clear the way forward. And no matter the path you choose, you are never alone. He will walk beside you and enfold you with His love from now until the end of eternity. So trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight.
Hello, I'm Pastor Mark Ammerman, and I want to thank you for being with us today, and I certainly hope you are blessed. I want to invite you to live stream to the pastor's study on Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, for a short message out of the Word of God, where God can lead you, guide you, comfort you, strengthen you in your life at this time. So again, thank you for being here, and I hope to see you Wednesday and Sundays.